Hello Sam, how are you doing?
Hi again, Jack. Good to see you. How are you?
Yeah, I'm really good, thank you. Are your exams
Nice one.
over? Are you done?
Yes, as of a couple of weeks ago, I am finished with my third year out of four on my integrated master's course, which feels very strange, a bit anticlimactic with the current situation, but yeah, certainly happy to have it done.
Yeah, definitely. We should be having this conversation in a pub right now rather than over Zoom.
Oh, that would be the dream. That'd be the dream.
Yeah. So basically, today I'm going to be racking your brains to talk all about civil engineering, what that means, what it is, what the career prospects are, and just finding out as much as I can from you as someone who is doing a degree in it.
Nice one. I'll do my best. I've been reading about civil engineering for a couple of months now, so if I can't do this, then I don't have that much hope for my exam results.
We'll keep our fingers crossed. Okay, so some people on social media have sent us some questions for you. I've also got a few questions of my own that I'm really interested to hear your answers to. So we'll kick off with Chris's question. And Chris wants to know why civil engineering? So what was it that made civil engineering so appealing and attractive to you?
So if you sort of scroll back to my personal statement, which I applied to university with, a lot of it was true, so that's a good place to start. I made it quite sort of sustainability and ethical based. I think if you are to ask 100 people why civil engineering, sorry, what sort of do you want to do as a career, so many people are going to come back with that they want to do good in the world and that they want to do a job that makes a difference. And I just thought civil engineering is a really good way to do that, pushing towards, everyone being able to turn on the tap and having clean water, and everyone being able to turn on the light switch and be comfortable in the knowledge that the power that's providing that light has come from like a sustainable source. So that was the really big draw for me, I think.
Yeah, so civil engineering has quite a big role in terms of sustainability. Do you any other examples of kind of how you can work towards that and keep improving how sustainable the sort of world is?
100%. So, civil engineering is a really good way to sort of bring a lot of communities together. So, for example, a site I was working on, very lucky to get some work experience on at the end of my first year in Durham, is HS2. So that's hopefully going to obviously create a perfectly electric a transport link between London and Birmingham, taking a lot of cars off the road. But that's a site which is also very sustainable in how it's being built as well. So with a project as big as HS2, filling up our newspaper headlines all the time, pretty much every civil engineering company in the country is going to be involved with HS2 in one way or another. So a way in which they're trying to push forward sustainability is they're saying, for example, any lorry that visits a HS2 site has to have certain emission regulations, has to have certain safety certificates for their drivers, in the hope that because every company has to meet that HS2, they'll start doing that for all of their other projects as well.
That's
So
so
yeah, huge
interesting.
projects like that make a big difference for sure.
Yeah, and kind of set the tone for other and set a precedent and a standard for other companies to sort of follow and
Exactly. Couldn't have said it better myself, Jack.
yeah. Well, that's why I'm here. So a big question that I have is what is the civil part of engineering? Because a lot of my family, my dad's side of the family are all engineers. So it's something that I've already grown up with, but what makes it civil engineering? Like why the word civil? What does that mean?
That's a very good question. I suppose it kind of, the dictionary definition of the word, being an English student yourself, of course, goes by people, and so it goes back to my first answer. But so engineering that helps people, and that's often through sort of through infrastructure. So infrastructure obviously being everything that sort of plugs into your home, really. So the water pipes that plug in at one end, the electricity that plugs in, the power lines, the phone line, etc. Providing all of that. On these large scale construction projects, effectively, it's not just Bob the Builder and his little digger. It's everything that goes on behind the scenes.
I see. Oh, really interesting. So our next question comes from Luke Vella, who wanted to know, specifically for you, what inspires you as an engineer, and what kind of was your first kind of the thing that made you realize, yeah, this is what I want to do for life? And he specifically says, do you have any favorite roller coasters?
Any favorite rollercoasters? He's probably read my Twitter bio there, I think. But yeah, in answer to that first question, first off, I said that my favorite in the UK, it's probably Stafford Park, and then worldwide, oh God, something at Six Flags Merry Mountain. Anyway, back onto engineering. I think the classic answer that everyone says, but it deserves to be because it is a great answer, is that when I first started being interested in engineering, I was playing with Lego at home, you know, I was playing with Meccano out of the box. Mm-hmm. And I think if you find yourself being someone who doesn't follow the Lego instruction manual perfectly, who goes, oh, if I add on that little extra brick there, that's going to look cool. Yeah. Or if I, you know, put on some stickers here and change it up a bit, or after they've built their Lego set there, they leave it for a couple of weeks, like, that's nice, but I want to take it all apart and make something new with it. You know, that is fun. That is engineering, fundamentally. Yeah. You're playing around, you're being creative with the tools you have available to you. Yeah. And, you know, you can do that so much more in a virtual world as well. You know, playing around with Google SketchUp and all that sort of thing. So I think what inspired me to be an engineer was wanting to create and make things, whether that be on a computer or literally as a child in real life with you know, construction toys. And you know, that can be the start, and it certainly was for me, just literally something as simple as that.
Mm. Do roller coasters count as civil engineering?
That's a very good question. So it's something I'm quite interested in. The physical structure of themselves, all of the steel tubes or wood in some cases, holding it all up, that's definitely civil engineering, or the foundations that pull it into the ground, all of those big parts of civil engineering. But it's also a pretty multidisciplinary thing, I guess, because you have mechanical engineers who will make the little wheels that will run along the rails, and electrical engineers to make sure the whole thing doesn't crash into each other and cause some sort of horrible accident.
that's kind of preferable, isn't it? I feel like I probably never think about all of the different like components and the different parts that have gone into the roller coaster when I'm on it. But it's so interesting how much goes into you enjoying your time on Nemesis Inferno.
I suppose that's the mark of a good engineer. You know, if we're doing our jobs well enough, then the rest of the world doesn't have to worry about how it works, because, you know, they can rest assured that an expert like us, fingers crossed, has done the right job.
Yeah, good. My next question for you comes from Shade, and the question is civil engineering fun, and also do you spend a lot of time on building sites?
So to answer the second part first, it's really up to you. So there's two main types of civil engineering. You can either be a consultant or a contractor. If you're a consultant, that's effectively being an architect, but way cooler. Effectively, you know, you have your multiple monitors with your design software, and you'll probably wear square glasses and have a very cool pen. And you know, you spend your time in the office drawing up drawings that are going to plan out the rest of the world for centuries to come. That's a very cool job. Very fashionable, and compared to things like architecture, it's a little bit more real world as well, and better paid, which is always a bonus.
Noted.
and then the sort of engineering that I've had a little bit more experience of is contracting. So yeah, if you want to spend time on a building site, this is the one for you. Effectively, your office, you know, you're still office based, but that office is also a 30-second walk from your construction site. And this is part of what makes civil engineering really fun for me. Is as much as I will have an office-based job and I will be sort of hunked over the computer like I am now, if I want to see what I'm building, I just look out the window and say, oh, there's a massive concrete stairwell that I just designed 2 weeks ago and now it's right there outside the window. That's pretty cool, you know?
Cray.
And, you know, so it's that much different to, say, for example, an electrical or mechanical engineer where they design a part and it, you know, it might get built in a different continent and it could be years before they see their final product. You know, I've always liked the idea that civil engineering is a performance, because you get you know what you create, you get instant feedback on, because you do something here and it appears out your window.
Yeah.
And you get that instant feedback, whereas, you know, mechanical and electrical engineering or indeed a lot of other careers would be more difficult for me, because the end product, by the time I saw it, I'd probably be on something else completely different, which would, mm-hmm. you know, have a little bit less tangible connection.
Oh, cool. So my next question comes to you from Chris, who would like to know, what are the benefits of being part of the Institution of Civil Engineers? So what benefits, what opportunities have you got specifically from being a part of the Institution of Civil Engineers?
So you get a lot of support. So the course that I'm on is a master's course, which is typically the path you take if you want to get chartered. Now, being a chartered engineer is just like being a chartered accountant. It's something you can put after your name. And it's something that if you want to start your own business, it means that other people can have faith in what you do. And right. The Institution of Civil Engineers are the best people to get you chartered. You know, it's in the UK, it's where you go. And they also have great links to a number of huge projects. So, for example, through my work with the Institution of Civil Engineers, I mentioned I'd done a placement a little bit earlier on that was organised through them, that put me in touch with lovely people at HS2. They're also hugely involved in projects like Thames Tideway. you know, currently I think the statistic is that on average once a week in London, raw sewage is put into the River Thames, which, you know, being one of the richest cities in the world isn't great. Yeah. So huge projects like that are hopefully going to stop that being the case. So yeah, being in touch with all those huge projects and working towards things like chartership is always a huge thing.
Mm. And you've mentioned a lot of kind of domestic projects that are kind of based in the UK. Are there opportunities to work overseas? Like, can this kind of work take you to all the countries that you've always wanted to visit? And is it kind of a global job?
Yeah, no, absolutely. We're both people that love traveling. Civil engineering is a hugely transferable skill. We're extraordinarily lucky, being from the UK, that civil engineers are very respected worldwide. You know, when we get taught about how the London Underground was the first underground railway and how Brunel built these amazing bridges way back when, you know, that does generate a really good picture of the UK as a civil engineering country. You know, our engineers are quite sought after. The companies have gone to send graduates out to the Middle East, building, you know, the incredible things that they're doing out on the Dubai coastline at the moment, working out in Asia, where obviously all of these huge projects that I'm talking about, like railway, road networks, you know, we need to expand a few of our roads in the UK, but, you know, the population in places like China and India is, you know, growing so much deeper that for every road we build here in the UK, they need to build 10. And so being able to work on projects like that is a huge opportunity. And the beauty of doing that as a civil engineer is that people often wonder, if they work abroad, you know, will they sort of get lost overseas, end up, you know, staying there away from family? But being an engineer is often quite tied to the job. So, for example, a high-rise development might take a year and a half to build. A railway network might take 3 years. But after that 3 years, you are then free to either return to the UK, go and work on another project in that country if you fall in love with it, or go to a whole other country entirely. So it's not like you'll ever get stuck in a country. You can properly travel the world and visit all sorts of places.
That passport is going to get some stamps on it over
That's
time.
That's the plan, mate. That's the plan. Fingers crossed.
Well, I'm going to build a bridge over to my next question, which is, obviously, things like overseas work and that kind of thing are quite uncertain at the moment. We don't know what the future will hold given the current global situation. And another question that we've had is from Satira, who asks, what new skills would engineers need to know in the future market? So what do you think, how do you think the market will change, and how can we kind of adapt to that?
That's a very, very good question. Obviously, a lot of the projects that I've mentioned are spending public money, which anyone who's ever spent the government's money will tell you is very good fun. They have a lot of it, and they're willing to spend it on important things. And that does mean it's quite, you know, recession proof. You know, a lot of people will tell you we're currently headed straight towards the Brexit recession or the Corona recession or whatever. So hopefully civil engineering will be that little bit more robust. And because of your skills as a civil engineer, being able to work with all of these different types of people across so many disciplines. I think a quarter of engineering graduates at Durham, you know, go to work in companies within, you know, a few months. So
yeah,
I think, yeah, there's huge opportunities out there for sure for engineering graduates. It's not something to be worried about, hopefully.
Yeah, I guess pandemic or no pandemic, we still need roads, we still need bridges. So
absolutely, and sometimes even more as well. You know, I was reading in the news the other day that the government really wants to push cycle lanes at the moment, because obviously the roads are being less frequently used. So now is the time to, you know, if they need to expand out into cycleways, you know, that can be done. I think Sadiq Khan was talking about that the other day, how he wants to try and get all of that done before lockdown's over, while the roads are that a little bit more quiet at the moment. So if any, you know, that's an opportunity where the current situation has made even more jobs.
Yeah, amazing. So my next question for you is, what do you make as a civil engineer? So what we've obviously spoken about the fact that there are good job prospects and good opportunities, but is it kind of a good job financially? Is it something that you can kind of rely on and you feel confident going into the job market that, you know, you're going to be able to afford your holiday to Tenerife every couple of years?
Oh, I never had you down as a gold digger, Jack, I must say, but we'll go into this one nonetheless. it's pretty good, as with many science, technology, engineering, math subjects. You're looking at something reasonably comfortable. I think around, you know, £50,000 a year, even on average, for qualified engineers, for those chartered engineers that I was talking about earlier, which is certainly nothing to be sniffed at. I know a couple of people who have started on graduate salaries. I'd say probably averaging around £24,000-£25,000 who are in the year above me, which is an amazing wage to be earning straight out of university. You know, that's about, you know, triple my student loan. So I'd definitely take that. And then even if university isn't for you, apprenticeship rates are excellent in the UK because, you know, engineering hours are often quite long, and some companies will even include in your apprenticeship hours your commute as well. So they'll make like a 10-hour working day with two of those being commuting, you know, straight out of school from doing A-levels or the equivalent T-levels. You can go straight into an apprenticeship, which is a really mutually beneficial thing. I know in a lot of disciplines, being an apprentice, you can sort of feel like a burden for the company you're working for. But, you know, I was testament to the fact that I was able to go straight onto a building site after doing only 1 year at Durham. And that tells you really that a lot of the work engineers do, I don't like to say common sense, because you have to, you know, your brain has to work a certain way, but a lot of it really doesn't require straight up, you know, huge mathematical knowledge, because nowadays the computers do all of that for you. If you have, you know, you can teach anyone to program, or you can teach anyone to be good at maths, but you can't teach sort of problem solving ability. So you can really come straight out of school and be immediately very, very useful as an engineer and earning a decent amount of money as an apprentice as well.
Amazing. I'm starting to rethink my career choices. I think I've done the wrong thing.
We've got a place for you, Jack, anytime. You know my number.
Oh, amazing stuff. Okay, so my final question for you, Sam, comes from k.w.price, who would like to know a little bit more about your application process. So do you have any tips for other people who would like to be part of the Institution of Civil Engineers in the future? And what advice could you give them?
So my top tip is that if you haven't chosen your A-levels yet, make sure maths is in there. You know, you don't have to be doing further maths and all sorts of crazy stuff straight away, but get maths in there. It's hugely useful, whatever job you want to do, from, you know, even if it turns out engineering isn't for you, from teaching to banking, you know, maths is going to be useful. So get that in there. Not all universities require physics, so if that's not your thing, don't worry. And, you know, don't worry about who you are as well. I think a lot of people think engineering is you know, just for boys or whatever. You know, that's certainly not the case. Certainly if you look around my lecture theatres, that's not a problem at all. So, you know, focus on why you want to do engineering, and, you know, don't worry if your maths ability isn't the best. You know, the people who are maths geniuses go on to do maths at university. They don't go on to do engineering. As long as you get over the line, you get that pass, that's what you need. So yeah, I just say really focus on what makes you want to be an engineer, and if you're applying to a specific company or a scheme like the Quest scheme, which I'm on through the Institution of Civil Engineers, pick up on what's good about that company and specifically what interests you. For example, how I mentioned earlier, how a development blossomed from just playing with Lego into, you know, wanting to make the world a better place through roads, highways, and train networks, helping people get around.
Oh, amazing. I feel all inspired.
That's what I like to hear, Jack. That's what we aim to please.
Yeah, well, thank you so much for chatting.
You're more than welcome. You're more than welcome. I've talked your ears off today.
So useful to lots of people who are hoping to pursue a career in civil engineering, and yeah, your insights will be really, really useful. So thank you. So thank you so much for watching this video. We hope you enjoyed it. I've been Jack. This has been Sam. If you enjoyed this video, you can give it a big old thumbs up and subscribe for more from the Institution of Civil Engineers. I have found this chat very, very fascinating, and I hope you all did too. So thank you for watching, and we'll see you soon. Bye bye.